All right, welcome to Ridge Church. We're so glad that you're here with us again this Sunday morning. My name is Krista. I'm your pre-service host, and we've been having conversations with many of our legacy crew. So that's anyone that's been attending our church for 35, 40, 45 years, some for many more years. And we've just been hearing some really rich stories around what it means to have been a part of this church, this community. And this morning we have another guest with us. Would you mind introducing us to who you are?
Oh, yes. I'm Larry Gustafson.
Yes. And what year did you start attending MRBC or Ridge Church?
Well, I was like many children. I actually was coming to Maple Ridge Baptist Church before I was even born.
Oh, okay. Oh, my goodness. And what year would that have been?
Well, I was born in 1949.
Oh, man. And, mm-hmm. So that's, you've been around for quite some time. Now, mm-hmm. For most people, who is your mom? Tell us who your mom was.
My mom is June Gustafson.
Yes, sorry. Yes, yeah. And you have this really great story of how you came into this world. Tell us that story.
Yes, well, actually, mom has always been known as, because of her involvement in Daily Vacation Bible School. And the wonderful closing programs were so amazing.
Yes.
And she missed the closing program because she was rushed into Royal Columbian Hospital so that I could enter the world.
Oh my goodness, that's so amazing. You mm-hmm. literally could have been born in a pew. That's beautiful. Now, many people talk about your mom as Auntie June, is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah. And I know she was really integral in the VBS and the children's ministry here. And tell us about when you started to sort of follow after Jesus. What did that look like for you?
Oh, well, for me, it was an easy decision because of the love that was around me and the love for Jesus that was around me. And so that wasn't a hard decision. I know sometimes when I was older in my teens and so on, I was kind of jealous of people who had sort of a rougher time in life and then come to know the Lord.
Right.
Because for me, it just seemed to be natural, you know, and a decision that that I wanted to make when I was young. And I, you know, was so thankful for that.
Wow. Do you remember how old you were?
I was 4 at the time.
Wow.
I know that from being told. So I can't exactly remember the time. I just remember what it meant.
Wow. Now, how many, all these years later, would you mind sharing, was it worth it? Is it worth it to have followed Jesus all these years?
Oh, I can't imagine it not being worth it. It's been a wonderful life and a very meaningful life.
Mm. Yeah. Thank you. You know, thinking about sort of being involved in our church and sort of also in the fact that we've always been involved in the city and Maple Ridge and Pitt Meadows, what would you say the impact has been on our town?
I think it's been a tremendous impact through, you know, these many years and continues to be as a place where people know and love the Lord and believe in something bigger than ourselves.
Right.
And want to share with others, not just share what we believe, but also share in other ways to help people in day to day.
Now, you talked about, DVBS or Daily Vacation Bible School. And so I know that would have been a big outreach sort of ministry. Is that right?
Yes, that was.
Mm-hmm. And so when you would have gone to school, you would have invited friends to that?
Yes, to Vacation Bible School.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Was there any other ministries that were sort of like that, that would have been sort of outreach-based?
Some that were ministries largely to those of us that were in the church already, but could include others.
Right.
Things like the vacations we'd go on together each year, the caravans with 10, 20, 30, up to, I think, 50 families or more, and then other guests that would come along with the families.
Right.
And travel up over the Hope Princeton Highway and go to a place in the Okanagan.
Right.
And then just have the whole site, reserved there for us. And we'd spend a few days together.
That's amazing, because that wouldn't have really been a church event, you know, put on by the church. Would it have been? Or was it just something that you guys did because you were friends with each other?
It was something that a few people came together and thought would be a good idea, and then people were welcome to come along.
That's so neat, because again, that's that picture of really doing life together and being sort of like a family, even though, I mean, some were related, right? But there's a lot of people that weren't, and that just became like aunts and uncles and siblings almost, cousins.
Yeah, they did. I mean, they really did. In fact, you know, still think of the parents as aunts and uncles, and still think of many of the people as cousins or even closer than cousins.
Yes. You know, I know you shared with me a story of serving alongside some of your friends and sort of ushering. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, that was a neat thing, because that again showed how the church cared about young kids.
Right.
I can't remember how old we were, maybe 9 years old.
Yeah.
And Robin Robinson and I were, you know, asked to be ushers.
Right.
And it was very special. Robin was outgoing, I was super shy, but that helped, you know, he had to say hello to people.
Right, yeah. Yeah, you couldn't just stand there being, so neat.
And so that was special, ministries like that and other opportunities. You know, great Sunday school teachers for me when I was growing up, and amazing ones. I remember one who was probably in his 90s at the time.
Wow.
And a person who had been in his Sunday school class came and sat down. I think it was at a memorial service, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
And he looked at him and asked how his younger brother was doing.
Wow.
You know, he just remembered all of that. And he had prayed for his Sunday school class members all the time.
Yeah.
I often feel guilty, as much as I loved being you know, with some very, very special young people as Sunday school students.
Yeah.
I didn't pray for them like Mr. Gerbrandt did.
Wow.
And, you know, and yet I know lots of people were, and I was sometimes too, not as regular as he did perhaps, but, you know, seeing them and being able to watch them into adult, you know, as they became adults and went on and have served the Lord in wonderful, wonderful ways.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear from you or other people that sort of talk about just people that were faithfully praying for you and that actually really cared about you in life, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't a duty or a job. It was something that was organic and natural.
Yeah. And so kids that grew up in the church had Sunday school teachers from, you know, all the different ages and many of them praying for them.
Yes.
Regularly, and I know many were praying for me through the years.
Yes. Yeah. Who would have been sort of that one person or a couple people or a program that would have, like a mentor or something that was really impactful in your life? Maybe more of a person? Is there someone?
Well, someone as people, but people in programs too.
Yes.
People like George Davison.
Yes.
And Mr. Ladd.
Yes.
Ted Ladd.
Yes.
And then, as I mentioned, some of the Sunday school teachers, Mr. Workman.
Right.
And so there were so many that were influential in that and encouraged in different ways. Also some who, I didn't mention Vern Middleton, I don't think.
No,
but
yes.
Growing up with his testimony. Mm. And then the Birch family.
Right.
The Birch family was a tremendous, had tremendous impact on my life.
Mm.
Because it was actually at the, we knew the Birch family well because they were friends with my grandparents.
Okay.
I knew Art because he had come into the church sometimes as a young, when he was
really,
really, really young.
Yes.
Mom always had a special place in her heart for Art.
Yeah.
They were back on a home assignment.
Yeah.
In Ladner. And their eldest son, John, was asked to take a message to, you know, one of the parishioners in the church. And he had just finished fixing his motorcycle. And he was hit by a vehicle and he passed away. And I was only five, but I was at the memorial service. And at that service, many young people committed their lives to missionary service.
Wow.
Because he could. And I ended up having the privilege of even working with one.
Wow.
That did that. And that became my, you know, my, what I, you know, really wanted to do for the Lord and for John and family was to, work towards becoming a missionary doctor, and had lots of encouragement in that over the years. My aunt, who gave me my first stethoscope at age 6.
Really?
And others, and my family doctor, who would always, every time I'd go in, we'd chat about how school was doing,
right.
And he'd encourage me, and just those encouragements to follow up on that. So that, of course, has been very meaningful and has been through the years. And others in the Birch family, Helen Birch was my music teacher. I can't sing. She failed in teaching me to sing, but she did help me to love music.
That's beautiful.
And Dan Birch was the Dean of Education at Simon Fraser University, where
right.
I did my undergrad work, and yes. one of my references when I applied for medicine.
Right.
And so that family has just meant so much
wow.
to me. And then meeting my wife Barbara at Bible school, with her commitment to being a missionary.
Right.
Just, the Lord made it all work together.
Yeah. So then you did become a missionary, right? I know you were telling
overseas.
Me sort of your this commissioning that the church had prayed over you and sent
mm-hmm.
you guys. So do you mind sharing a bit around that?
Yeah, in the previous building, it was just overwhelming to see and feel and hear the support in the old building with and full as we were commissioned and prayer for us as we went out, and knowing that the church was behind us, and it was, the way we kept hearing from the church and,
right.
and taking on some of our support to be there and just encouraging us and our children.
Wow. Where did you guys go?
We thought that early on that we would be going somewhere in maybe South America.
Mm-hmm.
We traveled down to visit Wycliffe
mm-hmm.
in Mexico City.
Right.
And we visited with Harold and Marilyn Haynes
yes.
there.
Yeah.
And then another time I was able to do through the Medical Dental Society and so on, do a trip to Colombia and visit in prisons there. And
wow.
all of this was coming sort of around the time when there were things like the Alma Ata conference and World Health Organization conference and Health for All by the year 2000. We didn't
right.
make it. But it was so much about public health in medicine and shocked at the high death levels among children in many parts of the world.
Right.
And doing something about that. So that became the commitment, and was to work in primary health care.
Wow.
And we were able to do that at Chicago Christian Hospital, along with a wonderful team, including someone who was so dear to people in Maple Ridge that we had no trouble getting support, and that was Hannah Lou Becker.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Just a beautiful picture of God sort of, or just prompting you at age 5, and then seeing the fruition of that, and the fact that you were, you kind of accomplished these things because of his movement in your life, and being moved by a memorial of someone that was so young, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I wonder what your prayer for the next generation would be here at our church. Like, what do you hope for us?
Honestly, I hope for continued love being shown for kids, which it is so wonderful, and having opportunity to not just grow up here, but to become involved
right.
in different things. And even as, really fairly young children, we can, understand that special thing that comes from being able to serve, to do things for others and do them in the name of Jesus.
Yeah. Wow. What do you hope, like, the next author, if they were to sort of write about the history here at Ridge Church, so not only being about children, but just, like, what kind of a people do you want us to be?
Oh. Well, just people that love the Lord and love each other.
Mm.
Yeah. And do you want to share that opportunity for that special blessing with other people?
Mm. So good. Any closing thoughts, Larry?
No, that's good. Just that thankful for this opportunity and thankful for this church and everyone in it.
Thank you so much just for sharing. And it's just really, again, so amazing to sort of see. I know you and your wife, a little plug for OCC, your Operation Christmas Child, you guys still continue to serve faithfully in that. And every year we kind of see our church come together and, you know, donate different things or partner with that organization. And it's because of your guys' leadership. And so I'm sure you want to continue to encourage people that way.
Well, yeah, it's a lot of people's leadership and dedication.
Sure.
And so neat that, you know, Joan started that so many years ago. And then we moved back to this area and or to the Lower Mainland. Mm-hmm. And she recruited Barbie to take that on. And it's just been such a blessing to be involved in that. So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you again for being here. And it's just been such a pleasure to hear your story.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Welcome here, church. Wasn't that great to hear from Larry this morning? All those stories have been super inspirational. I know I really love to hear about the history that's gone before here at Ridge Church. And we just want to thank everyone that was involved with that legacy project. It really was amazing to have everyone share their story. On that note, it's 10 o'clock, and we want to welcome you guys to Ridge Church. My name is Krista, and I am the pre-service host here this morning for you. And we just really want to encourage you guys, if you've been taking in only online church, we want to encourage you to come in person on a Sunday morning. July 4th registration is already open, and it's been amazing to worship together, to hear Jonathan and Dan preach live. And we have lots of room for you guys here. We have a 9 a.m. and a 10:30 service for you. And we've been able to maintain great social distancing. And again, just come and join us. You can find all that information online at ridgechurch.ca under the events tab. And registration is super easy. We also want to let you guys know that we have Ridge Kids programming at 10:30 during that service as well. So come and join us. We're so excited to see you guys again as we regather. On that note, we just want to also thank you guys for giving, for faithfully giving here to the ministry that's going forward at Ridge Church. It is not without your partnership that things go forward, and we want to continue to encourage you guys to do that. You can do that really easily by texting the word GIVE to 778-716-6722, or you can go online in our website. You can see the word that says GIVE there, and it's just really an easy way for you guys to do that online or mail that in. There's lots of different options for that. On that note as well, we've got serving teams. So this has been a big push for us. In order for us to put on Sunday morning service, we definitely need people. We need people like yourselves that are passionate about the gospel going forward and want to come alongside to build teams and to serve together. And we also believe that that is a key part of discipleship. So we've got areas that you can serve, whether it's in Ridge Kids, production teams, or even on Sunday morning in the guest services area. And so if you're interested in any one of those three areas, we want to encourage you guys, go and text the word TEAM to 778-716-6722. Again, that's just the magic number where you can go and fill out those things and go and tell us which area you want to serve in. Again, it's just with the partnering of the people that makes church sort of go on a Sunday morning, and we would love to have you guys be a part of that. So on that note, we hope that you guys come and join us again on Sunday mornings, and let me just pray for us as we go into service. God, we just thank you so much that through this season, we've been able to gather online. We thank you that we can now gather in person as well. And God, would you just continue to edify our church? God, we just thank you for being so faithful to us in this season. And Father, as we go forward, whether we're online or in person, just continue to impart upon us just new truths. We just pray that we are faithful to you in return, and God, that you would just continue to teach us more about yourself. And we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's worship together.
Welcome, Ridge Church. So glad you could join us here today. If you're comfortable, you can stand. And let's sing and worship our King and our Creator together. Come on, we sing.
When all I see is the battle, you see the victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. And there's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. Fight on my knees with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, and I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, can be against me. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Let your name Deep.
His love for us. How vast beyond all measure that He should give His only Son to make a wretched treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the foe that turns His face away, as wounds which by the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Father, and pray that those words would we find rest and would we find peace and comfort and joy in those. Oh, the love so deep that you have for us, your sons and daughters. Jesus, I pray that you would give us ears to hear, a heart with a posture of open-handedness to receive this sermon here today. Lord, will you be with Jonathan as he brings this word? Would it be your words and not his? And would you move in power, doing what you can only do, and drawing us unto yourself? Jesus, all this we pray and we ask in your amazing name. Amen.
Well, if you've been around here for the last year, you know we've been working on the outside of our building. We've been renovating it, and it will soon be done. And you've seen the images. You know it's going to look new and fresh and so much different. And it's going to become this amazing landmark, this spot in the middle of our city that people drive by and see every day. And we're excited for what's happening here on the outside. And now we want to move forward and begin to renovate the inside as well.
I remember originally hearing about this project 8 or 9 years ago, and it was exciting. And it continues to feel fantastic, you know, the support from the congregation and getting behind what we're up to over here and believing in the vision for the church.
I grew up in this church. The joke is that I was born in one of these pews. And so to see the revitalization of our church and our church home for somebody that's been here for so long and invested so much of my life into this church is so exciting.
We need this building to be represented correctly on this corner.
We've got this great building and we want to steward it well. We've got it because of the legacy of those who've gone before us, but we also want to make sure that it is in great condition for future generations.
We need to further our impact on this community, and the way to do that is we need to create an inviting space.
I want you to take a moment now. And I want you to do this for me. I want you to imagine. You come, you arrive at the church with your friend or your neighbor or your coworker, and you walk in through the doors and you walk into the lobby and it's new and it's fresh, and you invite them to a coffee and just an opportunity to find that place where they begin to connect with others around this place.
We have an amazing opportunity as a church family to use the treasures that God has blessed us with to in turn bless those around us.
I believe that the best chance for us to have success in moving forward with our project now is to move forward sooner. That is the best use of our money. If we wait too long, escalation and inflation that are moving at a rapid rate right now will come in and take some of our hard-earned money away. As part of that, we'll be able to use a lot of the same sub-trades, a lot of the same manpower and horsepower that are here to finish that phase. Doing that will fundamentally save us money. The time is now for us to be pursuing this.
Imagine what God is going to do through this place as we steward it well. Imagine the people who are going to meet Jesus for the very first time, the worship that's going to happen, the prayers, the discipleship that's going to happen in this place. And just think about the opportunity that we have through this place to reach our city, to serve our city in Jesus' name. We want to invite you to partner with us, to join with us, as together we seek to fulfill what God is calling us to in this place. We're excited again for the opportunities that lie before us in terms of renovating the inside of our building, and want to invite you again, please join us today at our general meeting. It's at 11:45. If you're watching this at home, you can see it online. You need to end this particular YouTube. Go back to our website, ridgechurch.ca/building. All the links will be there, but please do join us. Your participation in it is so important and so valuable. We want you to know what's going on and be part of the conversation. So we look forward to seeing you at 11:45. All right, well, let's turn here to the Word of God today. I don't know if you've ever seen on YouTube this YouTube channel called People Are Amazing. It's all these little clips of people doing amazing things. You know, they're unicycling down the side of a mountain. They're water skiing on their head. I mean, it's just crazy stuff. But it's really amazing to see what they can do. But if you're fortunate enough, you can also get a YouTube where you can see People Are Amazing clips, and right next to it, Fail Army, which is kind of the opposite. It's people trying to accomplish these things and then failing. And so you see it done brilliantly, and then you see someone just muck it up in a beautiful, entertaining, profound way. And what you're seeing there is really how these people who are so good ended up there by watching how these people messed it up along the way. And you know, so often when we see someone do something so amazing, we say, wow, how on earth were they able to do that? And in fact, there's a guy, a sociologist named Dan Chambliss, who studied this very thing. Now, he wasn't studying how people can do it for little clips on YouTube. Rather, he was studying it for musicians, and particularly in his case, high-level athletes. And he wanted to know, what is it that makes a high-level athlete be able to perform with such excellence all the time? And so he studied these swimmers, all kinds of competitive swimmers, including Olympic swimmers. And after years of study, he published all of his research, his finding, in a journal, in an article called The Mundanity of Excellence. He called it The Mundanity of Excellence. And what he concluded from all of his research is that those who perform at an incredibly high level are able to do so because they're able to do a bunch of sort of many small, sort of small skills or activities, each that they either learned or stumbled upon. They practice them over and over and over. And all these little pieces together combined cause them to do something with great excellence, which is very different from how we think of excellence. You know, when we see someone who does something amazing, so excellent, we look at that and say, how on earth are you able to do that? And because we don't think that it can be learned, we often say, it's a gift. I mean, what you've got is just a natural talent. You're just a natural at it. But Dan Chambliss, in his paper, he said, that's not the case. The fact of the matter is, if you could take a time lapse of the hours and the days and the months and the years of those guys working on it, it would just be this series of very mundane skills and activities that they practiced over and over and over until when they put it together, it provides this incredible excellence in their lives. And it turns out that when it comes to our spiritual life, the same thing is true. You know, sometimes we meet somebody in our life who is, they're just so dialed in spiritually. I mean, you talk to them, they just got such a vibrant relationship with Jesus. It just flows naturally in their conversation, and it doesn't feel pressed or unnatural. It's just sort of who they are. And we say, wow, how do you have that kind of a relationship with Jesus? And because we maybe don't have that, we can't have that, we don't think we can have that, we chalk it up to a gifting that they have. Well, you've got something that the rest of us don't have. You know, you're natural when it comes to spiritual things. But turns out that that's not the case. Just like excellence in sports or in music or in anything else, a vibrant relationship with Jesus develops out of the accumulation of a number of small practices in our life that we just practice regularly and deeply. And in this passage that we're going to look at today, Paul is going to talk to us about how that can be in our life. So if you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn with me back to Philippians chapter 3. Now, in Philippians chapter 3, you know, Paul, in the passage just before the one we're going to look at today, Paul talks about his deep, deep desire. He says, look, I tried to be right with God through my own effort and my own works. It was impossible. But now my heart's desire, my passion in my life is to know Jesus, to have the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. In fact, he goes on to say, I want to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection, sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that somehow I might attain the resurrection. And it's this profound, brilliant, beautiful passage. And you know, when we read that passage, either we're so inspired, we say, yeah, me too, Paul, I want that too. Or the opposite happens and we're defeated. We say, well, you know, I could never be like that. I mean, Paul, look, you're the apostle. You're Mr. Spiritual. Of course you want that because that's who you are, but I could never be that way. And so Paul now is going to correct our thinking around that. And he's going to help us understand that we also can and should and need to pursue that same kind of relationship with Jesus Christ. So here's what he writes, Philippians chapter 3, beginning in verse 12. He says, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. So, the Apostle Paul now says here, he says, you too can have a rich, deep, meaningful, life-giving relationship with Jesus. And here's how you do it. He begins in verse 12. He says this, not that I've already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. You know, too often Christian leaders, pastors kind of give the impression like, hey, you know, when it comes to spiritual maturity, we got it all together. You know, we're pretty much there. We got a little issue here or there, but pretty much we're good. And if you could only be as good as us, you'd also be good. But of course, it's not the case. And so sometimes also, I mean, it's not just Christian leaders. Sometimes just people around us give that impression. I remember once I was in a community group. I'd been in the group for a while with a number of others. And at one point, one of the guys said, he said to us, "I don't sin anymore." And I almost laughed out loud because I thought he was joking. But it turns out he wasn't. He spent the next 10 minutes arguing and trying to convince us that, in fact, he no longer sinned, period, at all in his life. The problem was that even as he said it with a great deal of pride, which obviously was a problem, but I also knew him a bit, and I knew his life a little bit, and I remember looking at his wife who was sitting beside him as he said that he no longer sinned, and she knew his life very well, and I mean, she just rolled her eyes. It just wasn't the case. And the Apostle Paul, I mean, right off the top, after saying, "This is what I aspire to, this is what I want," he wants us to know that he hasn't arrived there yet. It's not like somehow he's got it and the rest of us hasn't. You know, he's the apostle. He says, I'm not perfect. And he wants us to know, it's not like he's natural at it. It's not like he's got some sort of gift that the rest of us don't have. He still is developing it. He still has to develop it. And this is the first point that we need to pick up from this passage, and that's this. Knowing Jesus deeply is cumulative. It happens over time. It's a process. Like great musicians or great athletes, it's the result of this accumulation of a lot of little practices, practiced regularly, sometimes mundanely, over weeks and months and years, that lead us to that kind of a relationship with Jesus. And Paul wants us to know right off the top, that's who he is, and therefore that's who we are. In fact, this idea that somehow he's got this special gift that we can't have is something that he wants to make sure we don't think. The philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, he thinks about this a fair bit. Here's what he writes about those who are really excellent. He says, "With everything perfect, we do not ask how it came to be. Instead, we rejoice in the present fact as though it came out of the ground by magic." In other words, he says, when you see someone who's really good, you don't think about the process. You just say, "Whoa, that guy is amazing." But he goes on to write this: "No one can see in the work of the artist how it became. That is its advantage, for wherever one can see the act of becoming, one grows somewhat cool." In other words, he says, look, if you could see all the hours of practice that go into the performance of an Olympic gymnast, suddenly it would seem fairly mundane and not quite so glamorous. And really what he's saying is this: what we want to see is just the finished product. We just want to see the amazing thing. And we look at that and we say, wow. He says, we want to see the mystery instead of the mundane. He says, there's a reason why. And here's what he writes. He says, "Our vanity, our self-love promotes the cult of the genius. For if we think of genius as something magical, we're not obliged to compare ourselves and find ourselves lacking. To call something divine means here there is no need to compete." In other words, he says, if we can say, look, they just did that because they're special, then we don't have to consider that we need to do it as well. And that's what the Apostle Paul wants to avoid here. He doesn't want us to think that somehow he's a unicorn, that he's so unique. He's the apostle. Therefore, you know, we could never be like him. Instead, what he's saying here is he works at it too. He's worked at it for many years, and he's calling us also to pursue that kind of a relationship with Jesus. So the first thing we need to know is we can know Jesus. It's the result of this cumulative action in our lives over months and years. But then in verse 13 and 14, he goes on to say, what are those actions that we need to do? He says this: "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." He says this. He says, first of all, forgetting what's behind. And what he says is this: is knowing Jesus deeply involves jettisoning excess baggage. Now, to jettison something, it means that it's a term that refers to if you're on a boat or a plane and it's going down, you start shoveling stuff out the back end, over the edge, because what you're trying to do is to stabilize that boat or that plane so that it doesn't crash. Jettisoning things is about shedding the stuff that will slow you down or cause you to crash. And you know this, if you've ever hiked up a mountain with someone who packed way too much stuff in their backpack, about a third of the way up, they're saying, wow, this thing is so heavy. They take their backpack off, they reach in, they pull out like 12 cans of Coke. They're like, this is too much. And they usually turn to you and say, here, you carry this for me. what? And then they pull out like 12 apples. They're like, well, these are biodegradable. They chuck them in the forest where they can biodegrade it. And then they pull out like a giant battery for their flashlight. They're like, it's not biodegradable. I'll just tuck it under these leaves here and I'll pick it up on the way down. But they're jettisoning all of this stuff because they won't make it to the top if they carry all of that weight. And this is what the Apostle Paul is saying when it comes to knowing Jesus more. He says, there's some things that we need to jettison from our life. And one of those things is the hurt in our life from other Christians. You know, we have this call as followers of Jesus to walk together in community. And when we walk together in community, it is brilliant, it is encouraging, it is strengthening, it's beautiful. But sometimes we get hurt along the way. Sometimes either those who are Christian leaders or people that we're just walking with do things that cause us hurt, that cause us harm, that injure us. And that hurt becomes a weight that we carry in our journey with Jesus. And what Paul says is we need to jettison that. We need to leave behind those hurts in our life. Now, listen, I'm not talking here about ignoring things like sexual sins or power abuse by Christian leaders or financial fraud. I mean, those are the kind of things that need to come out. They need to come into the light and be dealt with. So that's not what I'm talking about. But what I'm talking about is the other hurts, the hurt feelings, the misunderstandings, sometimes the open betrayal and just downright nastiness that happens. And, you know, these things come in our lives and we have this choice, you know, will we remain victims of that or are we going to move on? Because clearly, hard things, bad things happen, right? I mean, you could convince a jury, you could say, this is what happened. A jury would say, yes, absolutely. What happened there should not have happened. But the fact of the matter is, it did happen. And so you have to decide what to do. You know, it's like as if you've been shot. I hope you've never been shot. But, you know, if you watch, you know, someone shoots you, in that moment, you've got a decision to make. You know, the blood is starting to pour out, and either you can go after the person who shot you and try and get them, or you can turn and race to the hospital and try to get healing. Now, of course, in the action movies, the hero always just sort of holds whatever the wound is, goes after the bad guy and gets him. But that's not the real life. I mean, in real life, that's foolishness. In real life, you bleed out trying to do that, or the guy turns and shoots you dead again. In real life, the answer is you go to the hospital as quick as you can and you allow the police or someone else to deal with the shooter. And yet so often when it comes to the spiritual and the emotional shots that we take the exact opposite approach. Rather than going to the one who can give healing in our life, we fixate on the one who shot us. And as a result, we begin to bleed out spiritually and the spiritual life sort of wanes out of us because instead of keeping our eyes on Jesus, which is the goal, instead we're fixated on this person or this situation that caused us so much harm. You know, there's this story about, it comes from the Civil War in the United States by the Confederate General Robert E. Lee. At one point, he visited the homestead of a lady in Kentucky. And the battle had been across her property, and she called the general over. And there'd been this magnificent tree out front of her property. And the Union Army had shelled that property and had destroyed much of that tree. There was limbs missing, and the leaves were blown off of it. And it looked so bad, looked ugly. And she pointed to that tree, and she was outraged and bitter and angry. And she said to the general, you know, this is what they did, and it's so bad. And she wanted him to be angry with her. And General Lee looked at the tree and he looked at her and he said, cut it down, ma'am, and forget it. Because Lee knew that tree, if she didn't cut it down, would remain as a symbol of her bitterness and she would never move past it. And you know, it's the case for us. Paul says this, forgetting what is behind. He says, some of the hurt in your life, you just need to cut it down. You just need to forget it and leave it in the past, because otherwise you will never get past that to the goal, the prize, which is knowing Jesus deeply. This is the first thing that you need to jettison. The other thing that we need to jettison from our life is the disappointment that comes when we continue to have to wrestle with sin in our life. You know, so often we come to faith in Jesus, and then we think, man, the sin in my life is just going to slowly sort of shed away, and it won't be long, and I'm not going to struggle with any sin. And yet here it is, years later, and we're still struggling with the sin. And sometimes that can lead to this kind of disappointment that Christians have that say, look, I tried. I've tried a bunch of times, and I just can't beat it. So this is kind of as far as I go. I'm trying to follow Jesus a little bit, but this sin keeps weighing me down. I can't get any further. But that's not the case. The reason why Paul wants to press into Jesus 30 years after he's come to faith in Jesus is because he's broken, like all of us. It's the human condition, brokenness and sin. And Paul knows that the way to deal with sin in our life is not to try harder. That sucks the life out of us. He says, I've tried that. Rather, he says, the way to deal with sin in our life is to press into Jesus. To press headlong into Jesus, and after we do that, to press in even more, knowing that this is going to be a process. In fact, at one point, the Apostle Paul, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, he writes this. He says, for the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we're changed into His glorious image. In other words, what he says is there is this process. We slowly but surely are changed as we continue to move through this process. And so the message that Paul has is this. We need to jettison. We need to drop this kind of an attitude in our lives that says, I'll never change. I can't grow. It isn't going to happen in my life. And instead, we need to know that we can grow. We do grow. We will grow by the power of the Holy Spirit at work in our lives. Paul says, we need to leave some things behind. But then he also says that we need to press on, strain towards what is ahead. And that's the next thing we need to know. Knowing Jesus deeply requires determination. You know, Paul isn't hobbled by the fact that he is a broken man, that he has sin in his life. Instead, Paul says, because of that, I just need to keep pressing into Jesus. I just need to keep moving forward. And again, according to the research that Dan Chambliss did, this is a sociologist who studied those with high achievement. He says, those who accomplish great things, he said, are people whose thinking is active in one direction, who employ everything as material, who always zealously observe their own inner life and that of others, who perceive everywhere models and incentives, who never tire of combining together the means available to them. In other words, those who attain something great, those who achieve their goal is because they strain and strive towards that goal. And when it comes to godliness, nobody ever stumbles into godliness. It simply doesn't happen. I mean, look at the people in the Bible. No one just sort of coasted into godliness. We should never be satisfied where we're at spiritually. We should continually examine our lives and see where it is we need to grow and then seek Jesus. To press in to know Him more, to work at knowing Jesus more through all sorts of little things that sometimes seem so mundane in the day in and the day out, but over the long term, change your life and develop this deep, rich relationship with Jesus. And that requires us to work at it, but it's worth it. And sometimes in the Christian world, we say, wait, we're not about works, we're about grace. Yeah, of course, but we have to understand the difference there. Dallas Willard says this. He says, grace is not opposed to effort, but to earning. In other words, the works in our life that are all about earning God's favor, that's wrong. But the kind of work that draws us into a deeper relationship with Jesus, that builds that kind of relationship, the kind of effort that we put forward for that, that's rich. That leads to a relationship that is utterly life-giving. And that's the goal. That's the prize. That's what Paul keeps straining toward. And he says, this is what wise Christians do. They continue to strain for this. In fact, this is what he says in next, in verse 15. He says, let those of us who are mature think this way. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Paul says this, knowing Jesus deeply is not a free for all. It's not up to you how it is you decide you want to know Jesus. You know, we live in this consumer culture where it's all about what you want, right? What size you want, what color you want, what brand you want, you pick, you how much you want to pay, you get to choose all those things. And too often as Christians, we take that same attitude when it comes to our relationship with Jesus, knowing Jesus. We want to pick when we want to know Him, how much we want to know Him, the way we want to know Him. But it doesn't work that way. Paul says, look, if you're the adult in the room, you understand that's not how life goes. The really good things that come in your life, the really rich things in your life rarely come through the easiest way possible, right? I mean, it's your kid who thinks that after six piano lessons, they should be able to play like a concert pianist. It's your teenager who thinks that, you know, because they're the best athlete in their local high school, even though they've never played on the provincial level, that somehow they're destined to be great international athletes. You're the adult. You know it's not impossible. You know that it's attainable. But it requires then from them the accumulation of an awful lot of mundane practice over years and years. And it requires them to jettison the things that are going to slow them down and that'll keep them back from what they seek to attain. And you know that it's going to require all kinds of determination to press in, to keep on, to move forward. And Paul says this, if you're mature in Christ, you know this is the case. This is what it takes to know Jesus deeply. Now, he says, if you want to learn it on your own, you're welcome to. It'll just take you longer. But eventually, God will help you understand what Paul's already learned here. So he says, you need to keep going. And then this is how Paul ends this section. He says this in verse 16. He says, only let us hold true to what we have already attained. You know, I don't know if you've ever done the gross grind. It's in North Vancouver. I've done it a couple of times. It's 2.9 kilometers hike. It's straight up the mountain, and it is 2,830 steps. Now, how do we know it's 2,830 steps? I asked that question too. Apparently, a bunch of people asked it, and so on their frequently asked questions, they said, who counted the steps? And the answer is, we're not absolutely sure, but can assure you that whoever counted the number of steps on the grind is a keen and fastidious gross grinder. Yeah, no kidding if you counted 2,803 steps. The point is this, it's steep and it's hard and it's long. But when you get to the top, man, the view is stunning. It is brilliant. I mean, all of Vancouver right below you, off to this side is like the ocean of Vancouver Island. Over here is the valley. The sun is out. I mean, it's so beautiful. And there's this coffee shop up there, get good coffee and some treats. And the feeling of satisfaction is profound. But it isn't easy getting there. You know, I climbed it a couple of times with a good friend of mine who does it regularly. We started out visiting and talking. And about 10 minutes in, I decided that oxygen for my lungs was more important than using and wasting oxygen on words. So I simply stopped talking. He nattered the rest of the way up like as if we were at a walk on the beach, but I literally gasped for breath the whole way up. Now, if you've done the gross grind, you know that after what feels like hours, but it's actually about 20 minutes, you come to a sign that says you're a quarter of the way up. And when you come to this sign, I mean, what little breath you have, your breath is taken away. You're like, I can hardly breathe here, and we're only a quarter of the way up, and my legs are like jelly, and it's kind of deflating to be there. But then the option is really just to keep going. And I remember one time hiking up there, and as I came to that sign, that quarter sign, there was a lady, and this was her first time up the grind, and I heard her say to her friend, a quarter of the way? What? No, I can't go any further. We can't go further. I have to go back. And as I came closer, I listened to her friend plead with her, say, no, you can do this. I mean, hundreds of people do this every day, just like you and me. And we don't have to go as fast as them, but we can't go back. Not only is it dangerous to go back, but if we get to the top, I mean, it's so rich, it is so beautiful, it'd be so worth it. And I'll go with you. We'll make it together. And you know, as I passed by them, if I had any breath in my, I'd have said, yes, you should do it. You should do it. It's worth doing it. Because when you get to the top, it's so beautiful. And that's what the Apostle Paul is saying here about knowing Jesus. That however far you've come, don't stop. It is worth it. Keep going. You see, this is the last point that is here. Is this knowing Jesus deeply happens through both grace and grit. There's so much grace for us as we follow after Jesus. You know, we stumble. We struggle. Sometimes we just want to stop and sit there. We say, I don't want to go any further. And Jesus comes and he says, no. No shame. No judgment. No condemnation. But keep coming. Keep walking with me. I'll walk with you. You don't have to go as fast as everyone else, but you just need to keep pressing forward. You need to keep walking forward because at the end, it is so worth it. It is so rich. It is so deep. It is so meaningful. It will be worth it. There's so much grace, but it also requires grit. It also requires us to put our head down and to have that sense of determination that says, yes, I'm going to press in. I'm going to continue to follow Jesus, even in the mundane things, even when it seems like I'm doing this and it's just a little thing, to know that over time, it'll make such a difference. And to jettison those things that would slow us down and hold us back. And to just have that kind of determination on our part. You see, following Jesus is both grace and grit. And that's something that we want to have as part of our church. We want this to be a place that is about both grace and grit. A place where you come and say, man, I'm struggling. Man, I have troubles along the way. I don't know if I can do it. And just to know the grace of Jesus in your life, grace from one another, but also where there's grit. Also where we say, yes, but this is what Jesus calls us to. This is where Jesus asks of us. This is what we need to do. So let's do it together. Let's walk together. Let's do it. We can do this thing. It's what we're called to do. Grace and grit because of what Jesus has done in our life. And in fact, this is why Paul does it, because of what Jesus has done in his life. This is why he's so intent on this. Because back in verse 12, the Apostle Paul says this, I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Literally what he says there is I press on to seize it because Christ Jesus has seized me. And what Paul is thinking about when he wrote those words was his own moment of salvation. He's talking about that moment when he was on his way to Damascus to arrest the Christians there and to destroy their lives. And instead, Jesus seized him, took hold of him. But rather than punishing him and destroying him, rather he set him free. He just poured grace upon grace into his life. And Paul has never forgotten what Jesus had did for him. And the same for us. You know, we should never forget what Jesus has done for us in spite of our rebellion against the holy God. In spite of the wrath that is due on our life, in spite of the brokenness and the sin in our life and the shame in our life, Jesus reached out and he made us his own. He adopted us as his sons and his daughters. He suffered and died on the cross in our place that he would make us his own. And therefore we should make him our own. That's why we press in to do this. That's why it's so worthy of us to seek Jesus. So don't stop. Press in. Keep going forward in what he calls you to do. And if you're someone who doesn't know Jesus, you can know him. You can have that kind of life-giving relationship with him. And you can do that today. I mean, in another place, the Apostle Paul simply says this, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. In other words, you can begin a relationship with Jesus. You can be right with God. And if you want to do that, you can have that today. You just need to do those very things. All right, let me pray for you. God, we come to you today, and God, we thank you. We thank you that knowing Jesus, knowing you is not something just for the gifted, for the super spiritual, for those who have some sort of natural talent. It's something for each of us. It's something for all of us. And Father, we can grow and walk more deeply in knowing Jesus as we have both grace and grit. Father, as we do these things that Paul lays out so clearly for us, God, thank you that he set an example for us to imitate. And Father, may we do that very thing. May we imitate him as we come to know Jesus more and more. We thank you that you never leave us. You walk with us every step of the way. We pray that you would continue to lead us on now. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and worship together.
You were the Word at the beginning. Home is God to the Most High. With Him growing creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name.
Dear Lord, I just thank you so much again for today and for the privilege it is to still gather together, whatever that looks like, online, together, in person, at our houses, or whatever that looks like. I pray that we wouldn't take that for granted. I'm sure week by week it can get probably frustrating. Would we not take that for granted, that we still get online services to worship together and still hear your word, Lord. And I just pray that we wouldn't just go into our weeks taking what we got from the sermon and just kind of pushing it to the side, but would we actually live it out during our weeks, Lord, and would we just shout your name loud in this world, God. We love you and we thank you. Amen.
Hey, thanks for being here again today. I want to ask you, would you please pray for our general meeting that's happening this morning? Just pray that God would lead us and his presence would be there. Make sure that you join us. We look forward to seeing you there. I want to end by reading you again these words from the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 3. I read them regularly because they're just so rich and encouraging. Here's what he says. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you soon.